Thank you, everyone, for coming. I apologize, class is starting a little bit late today. So we're the panel right before lunch. So we'll try to keep everyone on time. The panel actually is supposed to start at 11:50 and end at 1. And what we're going to do is I'm going to introduce the panelists, and we're going to have a nice debate, an explanation of what is net neutrality in India, why it isn't so important. And we're going to actually do something a little different. We're going to leave a lot of time for Q&A, at least 30 minutes, so everyone will have a chance to participate. So to start off, I want to introduce our moderator, Suki, from Dhanik Jagran. Dhanik Jagran. Readers, and Suki is responsible for running Jagran.com, which has 35 million daily users. Next, I want to introduce Nikhil Pahwa. He is the founder of Medianama, one of the first internet news reporting sites on digital media in India. And he's also the co-founder of SaveTheInternet.org. You may have seen those AIB videos. So Nikhil is behind them. He can tell you some stories. And most recently, Nikhil has been become a TED Fellow, so he's going to be speaking at the TED in Vancouver. Thank you for joining us, Nikhil. And many other accolades for Nikhil, which I will not go over now. Introduce you to Raina. Raina is a co-founder of a company called Maven. Maven has the first data-sponsored platform, mobile data-sponsored platform, with a product called Gigato. Which is effectively helping lower the cost of internet, making it more affordable for users to come online. Welcome, Raina. Raina's also a Harvard alum, so Raina, good to see you back here, Harvard. Also, I want to introduce you to Rohan. He's unfortunately not been on the pamphlet and on the website. He is the co-founder, Rohan Malhotra, the co-founder of Investopad, which is the largest tech incubator in India. They have three offices, one in Gurgaon, 35,000 square feet office there, one in Delhi and one in Bangalore. They've had 100 startups already complete the program, and they currently have 70 additional startups in their new batch. So very early stage, if any of you are thinking about setting a company up in India and need office space and need a way to start, Rohan would be the right guy to talk to. Rohan, thank you for flying down from Delhi on such short notice and joining us all here. And I'll hand it over to Suki. Thank you. Oh, I should introduce myself, sorry. My name is Gautam Gandhi. I am a mid-career student at the Kennedy School. I previously worked for Google for several years, and very passionate about technology and policy. Thank you.
Hi guys, welcome. So this is a very exciting topic, and it's very topical because this discussion is happening, I think, in all bedrooms and living rooms and dining rooms in India. So very exciting, and I think we have a great panel here that's going to shed some light on the issue. But what I thought we would do before is ask Nikhil to give us kind of a timeline and an update as to where we are today with net neutrality. And Nikhil, knowing how passionate you are, so hashtag be neutral.
I will. So. This debate began effectively on August 5th, 2014, when there was a seminar held in Delhi where telecom operators were asking for carriage fees from internet companies and websites for allowing users to access them. Fast forward a couple of months, Facebook launched internet.org in Delhi with Reliance Communications, starting with five states. On December 24th, 2014, Bharti Airtel, which is India's largest mobile operator, decided to charge differently for internet telephony. So if you were using Skype or WhatsApp calling, you would have to buy a separate data pack, or you'd be charged more for using VoIP. That triggered the Indian telecom regulator into action, and they said they'd do a consultation process. So just a few days after the spectrum auctions ended in March, on the 27th of March, they introduced a consultation paper which looked at a bunch of issues, including whether all websites should have to buy a license to be accessible in India. That was one. The other was whether carriers should be allowed to charge differently for accessing different sites. So if you're accessing Amazon, should they charge you a different data rate? If you're accessing Facebook, a different data rate? Flipkart, a different rate? or the debate that's taking place in the US about whether specific websites should be sped up or slowed down, depending on the amount that consumers use that data. From there on, a bunch of us got together and started a movement called SaveTheInternet.in, where over a period of, we set it up in about 2 weeks, and 12 days after launch, we helped about 1 million people write to the regulator, TRAI, in favor of net neutrality, or even against if they wanted. That consultation process was in a limbo. A parliamentary standing committee did its own consultation. The Department of Telecom did its own consultation. The Department of Telecom came out with a report which said that services like internet.org, where platforms play gatekeepers, shouldn't be allowed. Telecom operators, as long as they're not colluding with content platforms, should be allowed to zero rate certain services on a case-by-case basis. The regulator, TRAI, rebooted the entire process. The first part of that consultation was on pricing only, whether carriers should be allowed to charge differentially for different websites. And that process ended on the 21st of January, and a report is awaited any day. We've been looking at the TRAI's website every 10 minutes. We have a script running now which checks that site every 10 minutes to see whether there's an update or not. So fingers crossed.
So lots of consultations going on, you know. So there have been 2 papers, I think. And so a lot of public opinion has been generated about this. So I think, but the basic question, and I think all of us want to understand, what really is net neutrality? How do we define it? What is the impact on the customer? And how is the situation in India different from that in the US? And I'd like this to start with Raina, if she can give us her views on this topic.
Sure. So I came to Maven from a background of working with really difficult closed societies, dark net countries like Iran, and seeing what happens when you don't have free-flowing information, when you don't have access to information. How does it affect your decision making? How does it affect business? How does it affect everything? And that was sort of the doomsday scenario that I was coming from, and why we wanted to create a platform where sponsored data was a possibility, first of all, and then second of all, it was affordable to more and more small startups, as well as large ones. And for me, net neutrality is always, you know, gold standard. You have to keep everything open, otherwise it's completely not fair. And keeping an open internet, as we have now in many countries, including the US, take for granted and don't pay enough attention to. Yes, there are arguments at the FCC. Yes, people are trying to define it, but they're very complex topics. So overall, it's just something that has to be upheld for the future of the internet. And if you're not thinking about the future of the internet, you're going to end up in a place where a doomsday scenario could occur, whether that means blocking you from certain access to certain information, or even something as small as even knowing what your options are in life. So that's sort of my brief answer. Is there anything deeper there?
That'd be great, Rohan.
You know, I think that's, I think Raina summarized it quite well, to be honest. I think it's a matter of choice. Net neutrality is you know, to do with the fact that ISP should not block or discriminate any particular product over another, and consumers should be given the freedom of choice to figure out what they want to access whenever they want to access it. So I think that's really what we're trying to focus on here.
I can address that question about India versus US. The debate in India is very different from that in the US. It's always been here about whether sites should be throttled or not, and whether carriers should have the power to throttle. Now, what happens in a country like India where all connections are slow, so even if you throttle it, I mean, your only option is to not make it accessible, right? So when all connections are slow, what influences consumer choice? In a country that's as price sensitive as ours, it's about the cost of access. So the definition of net neutrality that we endorse is the one given by Vishal Mishra from Colombia, where he says that that the internet is a platform where the carrier or the ISP does not give, does not have the right or the power to give a competitive advantage to any service that's being accessed. That means that the carrier has to be source independent, whether in terms of speed, whether in terms of availability, or in terms of cost of access. The cost of access is now only beginning in the US with, you must have seen, with the Binge On plan. Yesterday there was a report that even Verizon is throttling video that it's that is not its own video service. So that debate, I think you guys will come around to in about a year's time. India's already there.
So I think, I mean, we've talked a lot about the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. So a lot of questions have been asked, and they asked in the last paper four major questions. The one that we think is like the most meaningful in terms of this discussion is, should the telecom service providers be allowed to offer differentiated pricing for data usages for addressing different types of websites, applications, or platforms? And in terms of thinking about this question, we want to really think about three or four different areas. Are there any type of web services that we feel should have differentiated access, such as public services, emergency services? Is there anything, or even free services for the poor? The second question that we would like to pose when framing this answer. We have 1-800 services. They've always been offered. The telecom operators always put this up. Why is it so different when we start to talk about data? The third, we want, how much should government really be involved in this debate? Is this really something about the industry figuring it out, or is this something that the government should really put down regulation? And the fourth, what do we think will be the biggest benefit to the consumer? And I'm going to start again with you, Nikhil. I'm sure you have lots of point of views on this.
So I have a long answer. I'm happy to go last.
Okay, who has a short answer then?
Could you just go over your first question again, please?
My first question is, should the telecom service providers be allowed to have differential pricing for data usage for accessing different websites, applications, and platforms? And please think about this widely. That includes any type of website, and that's why we're asking, could it be public services? Could it be emergency services? Is there any case, or even services for the poor, where differentiated access should be a possibility? Second, how do we think about 1-800 services in this context, which have been allowed almost all around the world? How much should the government be involved in this debate and this discussion and the policy making? And how will this eventually affect the consumer? So I know it's a long question.
I think the other mics are also
working. Yeah, why don't I start with part one and then we can try and break it down from there. Look, as far as the telecom authorities are concerned, I think, you know, the straightforward answer is really no, because they're essentially defying every act of net neutrality by being able to control what you can and can and can't have access to. Now, larger third-party players have tried to come on board and define that these particular websites or apps may be okay to use. Free Basics is essentially trying to do that. But, you know, the question is, why are they the final authority on choosing Bing versus Google for search, or using, you know, one travel website over another? So I think that either you try and regulate whichever third party is trying to do that, or you're actually completely defying everything that net neutrality stands for.
Okay. And I'm a fan of public-private partnerships. When I was working at the State Department, when I was working in the Obama administration, these were ways of getting things done that would help a great swath of the population without violating laws and without serving a single commercial interest. So there are ways to do it with government involvement and with corporate involvement without saying something like, this is just our growth strategy, Facebook. So I think that's sort of one of the answers. Differentiated pricing is something that you have to really, before you decide a black and white answer, you have to go through every scenario. So you have to have a flexible situation where something like a public-private partnership might allow for that. Since everyone doesn't know the answers right now, we don't know what the future situations may hold, it's hard to say that this is absolutely black and white and right and wrong.
Okay, so I would disagree there, because we have data. So where I'm coming from is a situation for a type of service called mobile value-added services. So those are ringback tones, wallpapers, etc., which carriers were selling on their own platforms. Now, all the companies providing that information or that content were essentially vendors for carriers, because the carriers controlled what consumers could access, and they exercise that control. So they actually had a member of their team. Airtel has someone called a supply chain manager, which renegotiates contracts with these providers of content on an annual basis to reduce the revenue share for accessing. Now imagine that happening to the internet, where you have a supply chain manager who controls or does deals with different entities, saying this year we're going to price access to your site at 10 rupees per MB. Next year, oh, you guys are making more money, so we'll charge 15 rupees per MB now. That's the problem. The net neutrality debate is largely about who decides. Should the government decide? Should the carrier decide? Or should consumers decide? And also, are consumers in the best place to decide over here? Because when new users come on, can they even discover what the internet is about in a year or a couple of years?
How many of those people are actually first-time users, right? So
that's a separate debate. But I also have an issue with something, the word that you use called consumer. Are we all just merely consumers of the internet? We're also all creators. And the moment you start differentiating between creators, you also invariably start differentiating between consumers. Today, I launched my site in 2 weeks. It wasn't a business to begin with, but it became a business. So should you then have a separate treatment for businesses and a separate treatment for users? We are all users of the internet. We all create content. So I think that openness, which does not distinguish between business or user, business or non-profit or just a creator, of between level of usage, and you only measure in terms of how much data you're consuming and not what you're consuming. It's important to retain that, because that gives entrepreneurs and even citizens the right to mix audio, video, text, and interactivity and create consumer experiences which have never existed before. That is the freedom that we're essentially fighting for. On the 1-800 service point.
Yeah, please answer that, because that's, I think that's the telco's biggest argument. 1-800 services have been around.
Yeah.
They've been allowing the corporates to pay for them. We all love them. Mm-hmm. You know, you feel very free. It doesn't matter. You can talk for an hour to your telco representative. So, I mean, how do you differentiate the two?
So the difference is that a 1-800 number is a support service.
There are also services that are running on 1-800.
Sure, but the internet, it is your entire business. And the moment you give a carrier an opportunity to create control. Now, also, let's look at it from a game theory perspective, right? Once your site is on a platform, your competitors also will be forced to join. Otherwise, they'll be granting you a competitive advantage. And then there's a prisoner's dilemma that kicks in. Who will leave? And that gives the platform owner a disproportionate advantage in terms of controlling how your business operates in terms of increasing cost. Who leaves first is the most... And that's why Times of India hasn't left Free Basics. It's still on.
I mean, we are all part of it still, right? We are all kind of watching what's happening.
And also, that's the reason, I mean, Gotham's here, that's the reason that they've given for not leaving, because all their competitors are on the platform. They won't... So effectively, you're all stuck. And if tomorrow Facebook changes the terms and conditions, who blinks first? Mm-hmm. That's the challenge, that we don't want to create that kind of a situation.
But Nikhil, you could debate that for absolutely anything. It doesn't necessarily have to be net neutrality. That tomorrow, if Times of Internet are spending XYZ on their marketing budget in a particular domain or fashion, then everybody else wants to jump in and form the same thing.
Sure. So may I address that?
Yeah, please do.
So if you have a situation, so look, how are carriers different from internet businesses? Carriers are licensed oligopolies. Sure. They have exclusive access to spectrum, which nobody else does. Mm-hmm. Four carriers in India currently control 70% of the active user base. Yep. They have, and at least three of them act in collusion together. They increase rates. So they're licensed oligopolies. Mm-hmm. And if you want to look at it from a public good point of view, it is upon us to ensure that they don't have discriminatory power, because consumers don't have enough choices of which carrier to switch to if they're all working together. You look at the filings that they've made to the regulator, they're all saying the same thing in different languages. They have industry associations which are again making the same point that four other carriers are making.
Sure.
So you don't have enough consumer choice, and therefore you need to protect both users and consumers through regulation, and I'm usually opposed to regulation, but when it comes to a licensing situation where there's exclusivity, either you do away with licensing altogether so that every single internet company can actually do a carrier, or you create a situation where the carriers are controlled.
Okay, we're talking a lot about consumers, and we know all consumers love free, right? Same case in India, very, very price-sensitive country. So when you do a poll, you ask them, Facebook says that 1.6 million people submitted in favor of it. So how should we take the view of the actual consumer? Some of them are very ready to share the data. You ask people, we've done polls in Jagran, I'm sure other newspapers have done polls. They're very, very pro free basics and other services, which give them access to a greater wealth of services. So how do you respond to that? So is the consumer not informed in India, or do they not look at the broader perspective?
I honestly think the consumer isn't informed at all. I mean, what Facebook did with digital equality, I'm pretty sure 70-80% of those people didn't really know what they were signing.
Yeah.
They thought they were signing something pro net neutrality, but they were really signing something pro free basics. So yeah. I'm sure you have all sorts of data to back this up, right?
So we've had people tell us that on their Facebook newsfeed, they saw someone said that his uncle had died 2 years ago and he was shown as supporting free basics. We've had people who've texted this out where they scrolled down on the Facebook page for supporting free basics, and their friends are shown that they've supported free basics. So there's this disingenuous campaign that's been run. But just to address that point about consumers, there's someone called Amba Kak at the Oxford Internet Institute. She did the research of users, and small sample size, about 75-80 one-on-one interviews. And she found that people prefer a limited amount of time but access to the whole web versus getting access to a limited part of the internet. Even Tim Berners-Lee, one of the who created the World Wide Web, has said that giving access to only a part of the web is a step backwards. And that actually brings us to the core question about why do we have this false dichotomy between access versus neutrality, when we have options that can give you both access and neutrality, and in fact, Maven is one of the platforms which enables that. So why are we choosing the worst of our options just because someone's running a massive ad campaign for it?
Yeah, I think intentionality is really important too, and I think at the back of everyone's minds is the intentionality of something like Free Basics and whatever an operator might launch, or operator and corporate tie-ups that are only working on one network. Those are the intentions to overtake the network in an unfair way, which creates an unfair landscape. And everyone wants an equal playing field. That is not always the case in business. It's not really an equal playing field. But you have to ask yourself, what is the intentionality behind some of these efforts? And where is the innovation that can come in this area? Because let's be frank, universally, nobody wants to pay for data. I don't want to pay for my data plan. It's very expensive. It's expensive in India. It's expensive in every prepaid dominated market. And there aren't really great options. For some people, you have to work 10 to 30 hours for 1 gig of data. And it is not the way it should be for something that is, the way I see it, as important as shelter, food, and water.
Okay. I think you have a couple of more points that you want to add.
At the core of this debate is this little line, which is, would you want free internet if the internet wasn't free? And the second free is, the two Hindi words, muft, which is free as in no cost, and the other is mukt as in freedom. And so do you really want a situation where you compromise one for the other when you can get both? Also, the point on innovation is, if your idea of innovation, at least from a carrier perspective, is how you price access to my business, I don't know how that is innovation. That's essentially exclusion. So there are just two data points I'd like to leave you with, I think, before we open up for questions, which is, One is that BuzzFeed did this great survey of carriers across the world where Free Basics is running. And they found that the primary target audience is students who are currently paying for data.
Already internet users.
Already using the internet. And they're essentially just getting discounts through this means for free Facebook. And this is something which is in consonance with what we saw in India, where Free Basics is being advertised as free net, free internet service, and even what Medium has this publication called Backchannel. Lauren Smiley was in India, spent a lot of time trying to find Free Basics users, and Facebook connected her with one person. I mean, this is Facebook's choice of person. Who was an internet user and essentially was getting discounts. So what happens is Free Basics is not an on-ramp to the internet where you use it for a while and then you switch to an overall plan. It is free forever. And even those users who've been on Reliance and using data for the last 10 years, say, right, even they have this access for free to these basic services, as they call it. So you're effectively creating two separate tiers for the internet. One is Free Basics and the other is not.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask one last question. You know, as we've seen most startups, most companies, we want to reach the maximum number of subscribers. We want to get to the revenue at the fastest possible scale. We offer tons of promotions. I mean, you've seen all the app promotions, 50 rupees if you download this app, $50 off for using Lyft. I've been paying $3 all week. I love it. You know, so, I mean, there's so many promotions going on. Why is it so different when a website would want to offer free access to its site versus any of the other promotions that we are doing? I'd like to start with you, Raina.
Sure. So incentive structures have always existed for businesses because, and especially for app publishers and businesses that, you know, are price per user sort of value add, they look at their users actually as the most important thing. They may not say that, they may not write that in their strategy, but everything is based on acquiring these users because they get pressure from investors, they get pressure from everyone, says you have to have monthly active, you have to have daily active users. And if you don't meet these numbers, you fail as a business. So if you don't concentrate on acquiring users, you fail. So there's two tithings that happen to every startup. One is Amazon Web Services. You give them 20% of your budget, and then it's Facebook, CPI ads, mobile advertising networks, 25 to 50% of your marketing budget. And every startup is in this horrible system where they don't have options, they don't have choices of how to acquire users in a cheaper way. So one of the things we wanted to create was something that was actually made for app publishers and was more affordable than just giving hard cash to everyone to do some high value action, and to give them megabytes instead, which is more affordable than cash, and to get them back into the ecosystem of using data so that they are continually always turning their data on instead of turning it off and shutting off access to different apps. So I think incentives are always going to be there, and they're always important. It's important to see what's ethical and what's not ethical in many situations. But giving a user something to do something is not, in its underpinning, a bad thing. It's valuing what their action is. If you're installing an app, if you're using an app, if you're making a transaction, these are all things that are normally awarded with coupons or cash all throughout business.
Rohan, you work with many, many startups, sure. 175 total to
sure.
date.
Sure.
So maybe you can also shed light on.
So look, you know, I think there's two ways of approaching it. One is looking at it from a purely investment perspective, and you're saying that products like a Free Basics will actually disincentivize a lot of the startups that we work with at an early stage and write sort of seed checks into, because it further increases the cost of customer acquisition. Your CAC is just going further up and up. So at an early stage, I think it doesn't really, you know, it really affects the companies adversely. I think the second part of the question is really to do with your data back and cash back and those businesses. Again, those are costs, you know, they fall under, you know, costs of acquiring customers. But then again, I think there's two levels there. One level is that is it okay for operators to control what we're doing or not control what we're doing? And, you know, hence the debate for net neutrality altogether.
because the data back or the cash back is not controlled by operators, it's controlled by that particular company.
Great. So what would we like to do now is open it up for questions. I think I'm sure you guys have a lot of thoughts and ideas. And Gautam, you'll be moderating the questions.
Thank you. Thank you guys for a very spirited debate. And I hope everyone, you know, has a different knowledge level of what internet policy in India are today. And there's a lot of things happening in real time. TRAI rulings are coming out and being debated. I urge you to kind of, you know, read the news and keep track of what's going on. You'll see all these companies and all these individuals in the news in the next several months. What I wanted to do is open up to Q&A. If we have, maybe we can get some people lined up here and here, open it up. We have about almost 30 minutes for Q&A. And if we don't have questions, we can resume the panel. Suki has a lot of questions. I figured, you know, you've been listening to a lot of people all day and give you guys a chance to speak. So what I'd like to, I'll start here, but if we can just get people who have questions just to come into the hall, into each aisle, that'll make it a little bit easier to coordinate. It's hard for me to kind of keep running up and down on the mic. And if you could just introduce yourself and keep your question to a question, if it's a commentary or a statement, please readjust it into a question. Okay, thank you.
Hi, my name is Dr. Arvind Lal. We are one of the sponsors, and I'm also a speaker tomorrow. And I'm the chairman, managing director of a pathology company in India, Dr. Lal Path Labs. My question is that many internet gurus and IT bigwigs in India keep coming and speaking to Mr. Modi. And what has transpired is, including Google and whoever came last, that the bandwidth which is available in India is getting narrower and narrower. And I don't understand why they keep saying that the military in India has backed the entire bandwidth. After all, there is a US example. You guys fly drones all over the countries, Iraq, Afghanistan, et cetera, et cetera. So doesn't that bandwidth interfere with the bandwidth which is available to you and me? So there is a very big regulatory question. The military is sitting on a large amount of bandwidth in India. Yeah. So why is that?
I can address that. Yeah. So
go ahead.
Sorry. So the ministry, so the difference between what's happening in the US and India is essentially our choice of mode of access. India has gone the mobile way, which is why our dependency is entirely on spectrum. And we've not invested enough in fiber to home, not invested enough in building out physical infrastructure. And that's always going to be a limiting choice. So as more and more users come online, you're going to struggle even more for bandwidth. The military, to be honest, needs the spectrum that it has for its own defense purposes. And I think I wouldn't want to go there, even though they have been asked repeatedly to release some of the spectrum. So Doordarshan, which is our public broadcaster, also was sitting on quite a bit of spectrum, which they have to release because they've gone from analog to a digital version. So there is spectrum that's going to be available. The government is essentially looking at it from a balancing of the fiscal deficit point of view, where they're doing auctions to raise more and more money. So they're piecemealing amount of spectrum being made available. Honestly, I think we need to start focusing on growing the pie, and the only way you'll do that is with wireline infrastructure, which is going to supplement wireless infrastructure.
And you know, the government has essentially priced a lot of players out of actually buying spectrum.
Spectrum
is so incredibly expensive in India, which is a big reason why your mobile phone bandwidth is so, so poor and so low compared to absolutely anywhere else in the world.
Mm-hmm. And
I mean, it's never been brought out that, you know, you need land infrastructure to promote all this. It's never been brought
Again,
out.
It's the same carriers that lobbied for internet access to largely be mobile in India because they were to benefit more from it, and we're suffering today as a result of that. So we need to be more open in terms of the options that we have for access to the internet.
There's other options too, and in time technology will help develop those out because the cost is so high of participating in some of these spectrum auctions, and those are using lower bandwidth and microwave and developing shorter wave communication on that. So there are other opportunities, but they're just not here yet. Present today.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Let's move on to the next question. I also want to point out that all of these guys are available. They're going to be here. I'll have them all give their Twitter handles and emails so you can meet them over the next 2 days. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Vaibhav, and I'm a student at the business school. Now, this is effectively about telecom being a dumb pipes model. So whether it is wireless or wireline. So let's say you're thinking about it like a, let's say I'm a telecom company and I build a toll road, right? Now, it's up to me as to what I charge, and effectively net neutrality is about I charge everyone the same price. Now, there are two questions which emerge from that. First is, let's say Netflix today has roughly 38% of the US data consumption market. So thinking about it like, let's say there's a factory which has 38% of the trucks plying on my road, shouldn't they argue for a discount rather than pay a premium? So shouldn't it be the other way around? I mean, thinking about it that way. And the other question is, let's say there's an alternative infrastructure on telecom or internet, whether it's a Google Loon project or there's this George Soros-funded Outernet. Now, if they build out a separate, I mean, it's probably 10 years out, I mean, or 5 years out. And if they build out an alternative infrastructure for internet, do they fall in the purview? Because they're, and effectively, it's a different way of providing internet, right? If they do that, do you think they fall in the purview? So it's a two-part question. Thank you.
You want me to address that?
Yes.
Okay. So just the second question first. They would need an ISP license. Loon project, all of these guys would need, or they would need to tie up with a carrier in order to utilize that same license. So yes, they would come under the regulatory framework in India. To your first question about consumption, right? So what you're talking about is that issue of, forgotten the phrase for it, but yes, you're talking about network congestion and how do you deal with that? It depends on what your worldview is. Do you deal with congestion by growing the pie, or do you deal with it by splitting the pie? If you charge people for what they're using more, that cost is going to get transferred on to consumers. Their propensity to use is going to go down, and so you're effectively taxing something that's actually working. Our point is you shouldn't be reducing consumer choice. And in a country where we haven't focused enough on building out infrastructure, let's try and focus on growing the pie by introducing an option that splits the internet into specific websites. Oh, the other thing, it's the internet is not one website or two. It's just, it is a network of networks. So you access a network of networks. The moment you start doing differential pricing, you create a private sort of a connection. And therefore, you split a public commons and you carve out private spaces from it then, and you charge differentially for it. So as a world, in fact, do you really want a sliced up version, a balkanized version of the internet? It won't be the internet anymore. There'll be a separate Idea Zero and Airtel Zero, Free Basics. Every user will get access to different kind of content depending on the deals. Everyone will have a different experience depending on the deals. You really don't want to go down that path, because what we have is this space of unlimited competition, which is giving us so much of innovation.
Thank you. If you can direct the question to a specific person also, if you have in mind, that would also be helpful.
Yes. Hi, my name is Roshan Kalgadi. I'm an engineer here in Cambridge. This question is for all of you, really. I was just curious if you saw any parallels with this discussion and the television industry. Television, of course, is used for entertainment, for knowledge, it's also a really good tool for business as well, right? But that's a tiered system. You pay for access, you pay for premium content. Is there a parallel between television and this discussion here? Is there a way to predict what might happen if we don't, you know, go along with net neutrality based on what you've seen with the TV industry?
Okay, go ahead, Raina.
I don't think that it's a real parallel. I mean, there's... some people were asking, is there a parallel between data and voice? You know, it's two things you do on the phone, but there isn't, because the potential for what you can do with data far outweighs everything you can do on single channel type of media, including voice, including television. Okay.
So it goes back to the point that I made initially about us being users and not consumers. Television is consumption. Imagine if you opened up television to allow everyone to create and everyone to consume, right? What would you get? You'd get the internet.
Hi, good afternoon. My name's Nirav. I'm an undergraduate student in McGill. And my question's basically sort of an integration of technology and startups. So it might seem as two questions. So my first question is, like recently we've been seeing a lot of people like in the United States or all over the world have been leaving their corporate jobs at big positions like Google, Facebook, Yahoo, and been coming back to India to like, you know, like either work in a startup or come back to their startups. I mean, it was just like about 10 years ago at this place where Facebook ignited the spark for startups, but it was still like, we couldn't see the effect on India. But like in the recent few years, there has been like a huge spark, which is like driving people. So like, is there a specific reason for that? And my second question that could be probably addressed by the whole panel is, speaking of internet and technology and going into a bit more specifics, applications. Like I recently read an article that like made me curious about it. Like, are we moving towards like an app-driven economy where we're like, everything's focused on the apps? I mean, like we're passing questions through apps and everything. So like, what's the impact of that on our economy today?
So I think, shall I answer question one? So question one is, look, you start seeing success stories in India. If you look traditionally at a macro level, beyond a point where there's 20% penetration on mobile phones, exciting things start happening, right? Now you're slowly seeing a lot of not only replica businesses like a Flipkart or Snapdeal, but you're also seeing a lot of indigenized businesses like a Paytm emerging from India. And you're actually seeing global players emerging from India, companies like Zomato. So that's one aspect of it when you see successful companies being built out time after time. And success is, you know, a bit of a question over there. None of these companies have seen the same success their Western counterparts have, but hopefully they're on the right pathway. The second one is every big franchise fund from the Valley or New York has come and set up shop in India now. So you name it, Sequoia, Accel, you know, Tom right here works for a very interesting fund that promotes a lot of interesting social causes as well. So there's a different tiered approach from a lot of larger funds that are coming in. And then there's your indigenized funds like a Helion, like a Kalari. And they're all raising, you know, north of $500 million. And the time is very, very interesting right now because globally we're seeing a little bit of a downturn. But India is actually just going up and up. And though the global wave may affect the amount of deals that are done in India every year, all these funds are sitting on an awful lot of dry powder. So if the companies in their portfolio are doing well, there's no stopping them really. So I think it's a great time to be, you know, building a business in India. I myself have seen a bunch of really talented guys move back from larger tech companies and come and try and build businesses focused, you know, on India. Maven is a prime example of that actually.
I'd like to add to that. So you asked a question about whether India will be an app-based economy. So this is a question that has been asked quite a bit. So if you look at the typical Indian phone, it's a 5,000 rupee phone. It can maybe store three apps, right? So let's become very, very real. We understand in the next 3 to 5 years, it is going to be a mixed market where you're going to have web access or mobile access and app access. Yeah, that's just a limitation. This is a thing that we see India constantly is a churn of apps. People keep deleting and reinstalling apps. Because again, look at the capacity, look at the type of phone, look at the type of bandwidth, and look at the limitations that are actually placed on the users. So within the next 3 to 5 years, it will be a mixed economy moving forward.
So watch for what happens after March or April after Reliance Jio launches, because what we're seeing is that as 4G launches, price of 3G and 2G comes down. In the same way, as 4G handsets launch, the price of 2G and 3G handsets go down. Features keep improving. So that's the way the way the tech industry works, right? New launches essentially make and that's where countries like India benefit because you get cheaper devices eventually. This is all going to change. I don't think we should look at where we are today, but where we're going.
Yeah, I'll just add one small point on that is that, yes, I think more and more things will be appified. And then beyond that, you know, like informal economy, we've seen a few attempts with, you know, rickshaws and chaiwalas and all kind of getting on-demand services and apps. And it's still a little early for some of that, but it eventually will happen due to convenience user demand. But as the cost of data does come down, consumption goes up. So the overall ARPU goes up. And then the price of 4G then becomes much more in demand and more people are going to try to get it and there isn't enough of it to go around. So people will still be paying through the nose for data, even when the price comes down.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Radhika, and I work in an economic development research organization in New Haven. And more of our research has been focused on providing access to the bottom of the pyramid, and most of this access goes through mobile phones and through internet facilities on mobile phones. So I guess my question is, shouldn't we have differentiated access to those at those levels so that they can access different services? As Nikhil mentioned, India has chosen to go the mobile phone route, and a lot more people in rural India have access to mobile phones and internet through their cell phones. So by providing them some level of free internet access, wouldn't we be able to provide them a lot more services than we can today?
I mean, I think as long as it's the internet and not an on-ramp to the internet is fine with me. I'm going to hand it over to you.
What do you mean by on-ramp to the internet?
No, so as long as it's not restricted to a few services. So I got a bunch of ideas which have been proposed in India as alternatives to differential pricing or differential access. One is that, so what Mozilla is doing in Bangladesh is that people watch an ad and then they get a certain amount of like 40-50 MB free to use it for whatever. And you're free to access anything.
It happens at airports here as well, I feel like.
Happens at airports here, right? There's also, so Aircel, which is a carrier, is launching 64 kbps access to whatever people want across the country, hoping that people will buy data packs for faster speeds. With Orange in Africa, Mozilla gives 500 MB of data every time someone buys a $40 handset. So you also have to keep in mind that those who can afford a smartphone, you can also offer them sachet pricing for data. There are ways of reducing cost of access, but again, we should focus on growing the pie, looking at bringing cost of overall access down, because what you've seen in the Scandinavian countries where zero rating has been allowed is that carriers or ISPs are not incentivized to bring price of overall internet access. There's a study from Data Fuel Monitor, I think it's called. So I can share the link with you for that. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Vaibhav, and I'm a student at HBS. My question is basically an economic one. If a business can create a lot of positive externality, which FreeBSS is doing, why should it not be allowed to capture it and subsidize the users so that they can access the platform?
Positive externalities for whom?
For the business and for the customers. So with FreeBSS, arguably Facebook is capturing a lot of it and using a small part of it to subsidize the customers. My argument is that if it was possible to provide low-cost internet, a lot of telecom companies would have done it. And your basic premise is that the cost of accessing the internet is much lower for a customer than the benefit they get out of it. But if that was the case, then a lot of people we see in India who don't have internet will be jumping onto internet.
So to address your point about operators would provide low-cost internet if they could, I think that's factually incorrect. Because that also happened with, for example, mobile phone rates, for calling rates. India used to have 16 rupees per call at one point in time. It was a regulator that stepped in and reduced the cost of mobile calling, which is why we have a billion people on mobile right now. Right? In the same way for data, if they had an option, they would actually look at keeping rates as high as possible. So I would question the premise of your question, that they would bring data prices down, because their propensity has not been to do that. We've even seen on broadband where data costs are actually lower, but ISPs keep the rates high. So you have to sometimes get in regulatory action to push that change that forces them to not look at their margins, but look at scale.
Reasonably free market, there would be a company which comes in and drives the prices down so that they can capture.
I completely agree with you, and unfortunately that's the point I've been making, that it's not a reasonably free market. These are licensed oligopolies, and therefore giving carriers that opportunity to price differentially is actually an exclusionary tactic, where they start excluding those who are not willing to make them or not willing to do some kind of a deal with them. Let's also keep in mind that with free basics, it is not that there isn't any exchange taking place. For example, I explained how the carriers benefit from free basics. in case of or how Reliance takes customers away from other carriers. That's the benefit that they get. That's why they're willing to pay for data right now. But even there, Free Basics gets all sorts of user data, and Facebook gets free. Honestly, and no offense, but I see everything around Facebook and Free Basics as sugarcoating. It's meant to make that platform look good. I have a whole list of issues with how they operate in terms of the terms and conditions that they set, how they force people to adapt to fit their terms and conditions. So if you're splitting up a public commons spectrum amongst businesses, then you need to ensure neutrality.
And there's obviously a distinct lack of choice in something like Free Basics as well.
But that's the whole point. It's not a lack of choice. If customers
There is a lack of choice today.
A huge lack of choice. It's not that customers are saying that we use Free Basics because they provide us these things. Yeah. It's a matter of them not knowing the world beyond what Free Basics provides.
Mm-hmm. Sure, but if they are not satisfied with the options they have in Free Basics, they can always pay and get free internet, which is like they have all the choice there,
Why
right?
Why should Free Basics be the gatekeeper to that, though?
Who decides?
No, it's an additional choice. It's not the gatekeeper. It's an additional choice for the customers.
Actually, the carrier is playing the gatekeeper here, which is the point that I was making. The carrier is choosing to zero-rate Free Basics. Sure. And that option isn't necessarily available to everyone. And so let's not get confused in what's happening on the Free Basics platform, but the fact that the carrier is giving a distinct competitive advantage to one player versus another, and that's where we want to ensure that there isn't distortion of markets taking place.
Sorry, just one final reword. The pushback on that is that people can switch to a different carrier, right?
Not when all carriers also want to do the same thing, which is what they're pitching for, but the regulator has not allowed them so far. I can give you submissions from each and every single carrier. And I have a 40-page response to all of what they've said, and you can take your...
Let's not go through all 40 pages.
So, I think in closing, or do we have one more question we will take?
We have time for two more questions.
Two more questions.
Hi, my name is Mohak, and I study development economics at Yale. This is a topic that was touched by the moderator, so I'm sorry if I'm asking you to repeat your opinion. This is about emergency services. So, what is the panel's opinion on, say, preferential access to WhatsApp, Skype for 100, 101, 102 calls? I'm not just saying give it to WhatsApp, but say all VoIP services. Or say Facebook's safety feature. It's efficient. I don't have to text all relatives if I'm in trouble or anything. It's an efficient way. So what about that, say, giving access to only that feature? Or is that unfair as well? Because then you're redirecting traffic to Facebook somehow. And if not private, then say public. But it's still like,
Let me address that. So one issue, and look, unfortunately, there are many issues that come into these things. One of them is that the only way you can differentiate one of these services is through deep packet inspection, which means that carriers will then be viewing whatever you're using so as to zero rate one part of it. So there's a privacy issue there. Secondly, the issue of who defines what emergency services are. I don't see Facebook as an emergency service. I don't see WhatsApp as an emergency service. I don't see Skype as an emergency service.
I agree with that. I'm just asking a small part of the service they provide.
So, police calls, so, like we have in India, right, the safety, so, you can press a button. Should those services be free? Women's safety is a top agenda item.
And I completely agree. So if there are, for example, and I'd look at it as a worst case scenario thing, because I believe there should be even competition in case of emergency services for a better service to come about. But there can be certain services which are like a 100 number, like a helpline for women's safety, which can be zero rated. But those services are also there on phone calling, by the way.
Yeah, but then if a lot of people say are already using that platform,
if someone wants to give their location to an emergency service using GPS, I don't think we have a problem with that.
But it needs to be universal. It needs to be across all the service providers. Everyone agrees, just as they do here in the U.S., that this is going to be free because it's an emergency. It's a special case defined by these three, four things.
Okay.
Let's take our last question, then we can have some closing remarks.
Hi, my name is Menka, and I'm a student here at Harvard Extension School. Since I'm a major work experience with a mobile content provider, and I've worked very closely with Vodafone and Airtel in Gurgaon, my question to you is, According to the recent case studies, as we all know, that the ISPs are the most influential actors for the cybersecurity or the data security breach. I wanted to know, what do we already have some security policies in place, or how is it going in the future? And the second question I would like to include, because it's related to this only. So as Nikhil also mentioned, and I've also experienced in my past, that all the ISPs have always, like, they are the driving factors of content. Do we see any control shift from ISPs to consumers, or ISPs to any foreign countries in India?
Sorry, I didn't understand that. Could you just explain that again?
So the second question is, as you also mentioned, that the ISPs have always been driving content. I mean, they are the driving force. And I have also experienced in past that while working with a mobile content provider, I mean, they used to drive content. They used to make the final decisions as to what should go on whatever service. But being we as a mobile content provider, we were not given that control or authority. So do you see any control shift from ISPs to the content providers coming in future or currently,
so,
I don't know.
So you've just validated my point that there was an extreme amount of control that was exercised, right? And guess what? The internet won. India shifted from being that controlled content space in mobile VAS to the open internet because the government held spectrum auctions. Carriers had to pay through their nose for 3G spectrum. And therefore, they had no choice but to roll out mobile internet services, which they were trying not to do for the longest time. And with that, there was open competition on the internet. Consumers got more choice. And people use more of that. Mobile VAS has declined. No, it's now stabilized. It's not declined entirely. But for Airtel, I think data revenues are now three times what mobile VAS revenues were. So there is a shift that's taken place. People have already chosen open. The problem with what they're trying to do now is essentially regain that control that they lost from moving from being a dumb pipe to an intelligent pipe. And that essentially changes how the internet was built. The internet was built to have innovation around the edges. And the networks essentially just transfer packets from one hand to the other. And the moment you have networks deciding which packets to hand over, what pricing to hand it over, mm-hmm. all of a sudden the control gets lost from the edges and the innovation dies.
Mm-hmm. And how about the security policies for the content? Because we have all seen the ISPs, they are the most influential actors for the data security breaches. So
I'm not very familiar with the security policies and on privacy, but if you're talking about encryption and of data, there was a terrible policy released earlier last year where users were asked to store passwords in plain text format and content in plain text format for 90 days. Obviously poorly thought out, but what we're seeing over the last year is that ever since the net neutrality debate began, users are becoming a lot more conscious of fighting back against bad policy. So I don't know how anyone could have imagined that in a country like India, there would have been a pushback from consumers against the ban on porn. And there was. I was surprised. I don't know how anyone would have ever expected it. It's because users are saying that don't stop us from accessing whatever we want. We want to protect our privacy, we want neutrality, and we want to access whatever content we want.
Sure. Thank you so much.
So I think in closing, we know that Nikhil has a 14-page paper, no, 40-page paper. It looks pretty thick. But what would you guys advise try to do? And please keep it short, two sentences each. Yeah. And what do you expect to be the outcome of the current submissions?
So it's difficult to say what the outcome looks like, but I think it's clear that we've given many examples today of the benefits of net neutrality versus using a third party like a Free Basics to try and force something down your throat in alliance with one particular carrier. I think the long-term solution would be for a platform like a Maven or many such platforms to be able to say that, all right, everyone has the opportunity to be able to subsidize data across different operators, and whether you're a product with, which is beta testing with 5 customers, or whether you're a Flipkart with 500 million customers,
you're allowed to access your consumers just the same, and the consumers are given a choice. I think that's what, you know, I'd like to really, really focus on, that consumers are given a choice as to what they want to access, and that and the data subsidization are two completely different things.
As far as advice, I would encourage the regulators to consider intentionality, to consider the informed and engaged engagement level of the citizens, of the users and the creators. And, you know, thankfully, because of Save the Internet and voices like Nikhil's, a lot of ink has been spilled, and this awareness level has become very high in India of this issue. But there are many places in the world where there's not even an article about this, where the same thing is happening. And if India can be the model of what can happen, this would be a really great thing, even for the US to follow. So everyone's watching and waiting to see what happens. And my guess is that Free Basics will get banned. But it's just considering the fact that users understand, consumers understand of the internet, what they are giving up for what they're getting.
So
not 40 pages.
So the joke behind when we started the campaign, something that a lot of people rib me about is that I said, can we at least get 10,000 submissions over to try? Like, that was a target. We hit a million in 12 days. What you need to realize is that never again will internet policy be made in India in a vacuum. Consumers are aware, they're informed, they're asking us to help them. And so we're going to work towards issues, I mean, addressing issues of privacy, censorship. There's a lot to be done, and there are people who are just coming and willing to help, which is a great thing. We're a completely collaborative effort, loose sort of a collective. What I'd like to try to do is ensure that the neutrality of networks is remain, that ISPs have absolutely no power to pick winners and all play a gatekeeping role of any sort, because that's the only way Indians will get access to the same internet that you guys have access to here. And I like what Tim Berners-Lee says, and that's a great quote to end with, all of the internet for all of the people, all of the time.
I'd like to thank all of the panelists, and I'd like to thank all of you.